It's hard, but it ain't impossible. Notice Jesus said hard, not impossible. Mm-hmm. Jesus could have said it's unbreakable.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Jesus could have said it's inflexible. He could have said it was difficult or problematic, but Jesus said it was hard.
Uh-huh.
But he didn't say it was impossible.
Right.
All right.
Right.
All right.
So if Jesus didn't say it was impossible, that tells you and I that it's possible.
All right.
It's possible. That means it's feasible. It's able to be done. It's attainable, achievable, realizable. It's within our reach. It's workable. Uh-huh. It's manageable. And it's doable. That's Matthew, the 16th chapter, starting with verse number 16. And you're going to see these words are something very similar. And someone came to him and said, "Teacher, what good thing shall I do so that I may obtain eternal life?"
Uh-huh.
And he said to him, "Why are you asking me about what is good? There is only one who is good. But if you want to enter life, keep the commandments." Then he said to him, "Which ones?"
Mm.
And Jesus said, "You shall not commit murder.
Uh-huh.
You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony. Honor your father and mother. And you shall love your neighbor as yourself." The young man said to him, "All these I have kept. What am I still lacking?"
Mm-hmm.
Mm.
Jesus said to him, "If you want to be complete, go and sell your possessions and give to the poor.
Uh-huh.
And you will have treasure in heaven. And come, follow me."
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But when the young man heard this statement, he went away grieving.
Mm.
For he was one who owned much property. And Jesus said to his disciples, "Truly I say to you, it will be hard for a rich person to enter the kingdom of heaven."
Yeah.
"And again I say to you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God."
All right.
When the disciples heard this, they were very astonished and said, "Then who can be saved?"
Mm.
And looking at them, Jesus said to them, "With people, this is impossible. But with God, all things are possible."
Yes. That's it. That's it. Yes.
Amen.
And this morning, I want to preach from the subject, "It's hard, not impossible."
I love it.
It's hard, but it ain't impossible. Notice Jesus said hard, not impossible.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus could have said it's unbreakable.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Jesus could have said it's inflexible. He could have said it was difficult or problematic, but Jesus said it was hard.
Uh-huh.
But he didn't say it was impossible.
Right.
All right.
Right.
All right.
So if Jesus didn't say it was impossible, that tells you and I that it's possible.
All right.
It's possible. That means it's feasible. It's able to be done. It's attainable, achievable, realizable. It's within our reach. It's workable. Uh-huh. It's manageable. And it's doable. I remember hearing this text as a young kid, and it made me afraid to want to be rich.
Mm.
Because what I heard was, it's too hard for a rich man to enter heaven. It's it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. So that made me doubt if I wanted to be rich.
Uh-huh.
But I realized, like so many other of us, that I misinterpreted what Jesus was trying to communicate to those who would read and hear these words.
Uh-huh. All right, all right.
The text says someone came to Jesus But what was interesting was it described the person as someone. But I'm glad the those who came along and who read this and wrote it along realized who was being talked about, especially if you read some of the other gospels. They say it was a young, rich ruler.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And to me, when I hear about this story, I think about this young rich ruler who came to Jesus as one who's possibly self-righteous.
Mm.
And reason I say possibly self-righteous, he come to the Lord. He comes to the Son of God. He comes to the Prince of Peace, the King of Kings, and asks this question: what good things must I do to inherit eternal life?
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And him being the self-righteous person, it sounds like he was to me when I read about him. It seems as though he's more about what he has to do.
Uh-huh.
It's about more. You know, what more can I do? It's about me. Can I? How can I? Should I? Where should I? It's about him being about self-righteous.
Mm.
And Jesus showed this young rich ruler that this way of self-righteousness is impossible, because there's nothing that we can do to inherit eternal kingdom.
Uh-huh.
Because none of us are good enough. None of us can work our way into this. So after Jesus eliminated this self-righteousness solution to sin,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
Jesus goes on to explain salvation is the gracious work of God. Not only did Jesus die to be the lamb that takes away the sin of the world, God has to work in our hearts in granting us repentance as well as faith. And he has to write his laws in our hearts with mankind so salvation can be possible.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Because without God writing the laws in our hearts, without the love that we have for the Lord based off the love the Lord gave to us, salvation is impossible.
Yeah, yeah.
But with God, all things are possible.
Thank you, Lord.
If you are searching for salvation, and if you are searching for eternal life, look no further. And just let this simple but helpful message the Lord has put on my heart about Jesus and this rich young ruler aid you in your search for your thirst for God. In this 19th chapter of Matthew, verses 16 through 26, this is the basis of our thinking. And a lot of us often ask ourselves, what more can I do?
Yeah, yeah.
Am I on the right track?
Mm.
Am I doing what I should be doing? Yeah. I'm supposed to be doing? And I've come to the understanding that there are three ways that we can live our life.
Mm-hmm.
And the first way most people live their life is they don't believe in religion. There's no religion
uh-huh.
to them.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
They don't believe they have to get it right with God, and therefore they live a life without faith, without religion. And if you think about it, it's a futile way to live your life. The second way is that we try to feel as though we earn favor. We can earn the acceptance of God. And we believe there is God. We believe that we fall short of God's glory. But we try to arrive at what God wants by ourselves. We try to get ourselves together. We try to make ourselves right. And in other words, what we find ourselves doing is we become yielded to that which is of self-righteousness. But do you know, over 2,000 years ago, someone asked a question in Matthew, the 19th chapter, verse 16, what good must I do to inherit eternal life? And I think this is a very good slogan for the philosophy of self-righteousness. What good must I do? to have eternal life. I believe in God. I believe that there's a judgment to come. Mm-hmm. I believe that there's eternal life to come. So what must I do to qualify for eternal reward in God? This question is asked by a young man in the Bible, and Jesus interacts with this young man. And this young man is not only young, but he's also extremely wealthy. If you read Luke, the 18th chapter and the 23rd verse, it will tell us that the details of this man's life, that he's very wealthy, and not just wealthy, extremely wealthy. Again, in Matthew 19:22, we are told he had great possessions. So he owns a lot of stuff. He has a lot of property. He probably has a garage full of about 20 cars. He probably owns a fleet of jets. He probably have houses in different zip codes and area codes. He's a wealthy man with a lot of expensive things. He probably have drones that he can fly all over the country and see where he want to go and what he want to do. This man here is very, very wealthy. How did he get to be so rich? Maybe he swindled money out of people. Maybe he was a crook. Maybe he cheated his way into success. But the Bible says he's a ruler. And he's a successful ruler. So he's probably a respected ruler of the synagogue amongst the Jewish people for him to be a respected ruler. So this man has got it all. He has wealth, fame, the respect of the people that he's around. He's rich. He has some form of religion. He's bright. He's a bright, promising young star. And the problem is he's troubled about his future. And I'm so glad that he knew enough to come to the one who can give him the answer that was needed.
That's it.
He didn't go to other rabbis.
Right.
He didn't go to other priests. He went to the one who could give him the answer that all of us desire to know. He went to Jesus. And he said, good teacher. Some say good master, a rabbi. But he said, good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? I have everything in this life right now. But I'm not just concerned about this life. And I love that about him. Because most people can't see past this life.
That's good.
We all have three lives. You know, they say can't have nine lives. We have three lives. We have the life that we were born into. We have the new life that we were reborn into, and then we have eternal life, which will be our home for the rest of our eternal life, be it salvation and glory, gloom and despair. We get to make the choice. So I'm kind of intrigued about this young man and this young ruler. He's not only thinking about this question as if it's a side issue. This is a question that really troubles him. And if he's like most of us, we all ask that question sometimes. Am I doing what I need to be doing so that I can assure that I will be where I want to be when eternal life becomes my destination? How do you know where your eternal life will be? Who told you? Who said, do you even believe that there's another place after you leave Earth? Do you believe that everybody just automatically go to heaven? Do you believe that how can a loving God send people to hell? What do you believe about this situation about eternal life? So this young man was desperate. This is a question that I think has dominated his thoughts for some time for him to actually go to Jesus himself. I know that because this man ran up and knelt before Jesus in a body posture that says, Lord, help me.
Yeah, yeah.
Desperately, help me. I want to know, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Maybe some of you today are like this. You've been coming to church every now and then. You have been going around church people every now and then. Mm-hmm. You do religious things before you eat your meal every now and then.
Mama.
You've been trying to find the answer to rightness and how to get right with God every now and then. You've been trying to find, what do I need to do more to assure myself of eternal life every now and then. I can stand with God and I will be blessed forevermore knowing that I have the assurance that God has given me eternal life with him.
Mm-hmm.
If you are someone like this, and I'm glad that you're here today.
Right, right.
Yeah, yeah.
I believe God has brought you here for a specific purpose that you may today know you can have assurance of your eternity.
Thank you, Lord.
So, self-righteousness is really what must I do?
Mm-hmm.
Instead of reflecting on what did Jesus do?
Yeah, yeah.
That's good.
Jesus interacted with this young man, and before he gave a direct answer, he first asked a question. Why do you call me good? And I thought it was interesting the way he phrased it. He said, why do you call me good? No one is good except God alone. And basically, he's saying to this young man, do you know who you're speaking to?
Right, right.
You say, good teacher, good master. But why do you call me good? Do you really understand the meaning of good? Because there is none good except God alone. Do you really understand God?
Mm-hmm.
Are you recognizing that I am sent of God? Unlike the many religious leaders of the day who say that I'm of the devil?
Yeah.
Are you saying that you believe that I indeed are sent by God? I am the Son of God, the very God. No one is good except God alone. Are you saying that? I can't even imagine what it was like for that young ruler to be in conversation with Jesus and Jesus asking him questions that he may or may not already know the answer to. So that's a question that Jesus put in the mind of this young man, causing him to think a little bit. But then he went on to answer the question by saying, what must you do to have eternal life?
Yeah, yeah.
And I truly believe Jesus often answers our question with another question before he gives us the answer to our question. Jesus said, you know the commandments. You are the ruler of the synagogue. So I know you already know. You grew up reading the Bible. You grew up understanding the laws of Moses. You know the prophets. You know all this stuff. And if you want to have eternal life, then keep them. What good is it to know the commandments and not keep them? What good is it to know them and don't do them? What good is it to know them and not obey them? And then this young man said, well, which ones? Which commandments should I keep that'll get me into eternal life? And I can imagine him getting all excited because he's probably gonna start with, I'm going to eternal life. I've been keeping all the commandments since I was a kid. I got this. I'm in there. Y'all heard him. I'm in there. I've been conditioned to obey the commandments. I grew up, if I thought about sinning, I felt like I would get in trouble. I grew up, if I saw a sin, I called it out. He could actually say that he did all that he was supposed to do. Oh, is that it? Oh, this is easy. I'm in. You know, I got this. Jesus replied to him, you shall not murder. He said, oh, I ain't did that. He said, and that was commandment number 6. He said, you should not commit adultery. He said, oh, I ain't got no problem with that. That's commandment number 7. He said, you should not steal. He said, oh, that's number 8. I'm good with that too. He said, you shouldn't bear false witness or lie. Oh, that's number 9. I got that one down, Jesus. He said, honor your father and mother. Oh, that's 10. I'm good with that. And I thought it was interesting as I read this right here in the Bible about the commandments. Jesus had basically changed the order somewhat to be 6, 7, 8, 9. And then he gave him number 5. When he said, you shall love your neighbor as yourself, which is really a summary of that. And he said, loving your neighbor, the first half would be more about God. You should have no other gods before me. The second half of the commandments, you should love your neighbor as yourself.
Mm-hmm.
So in effect, the commandments 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9 are about our neighbor as ourself.
All right.
Yes.
If I hear this, I would say, that's hard.
Mm-hmm.
It's hard loving myself as myself. So you telling me to love my neighbor as myself?
Uh-huh.
I don't know about that, Jesus. You know, I can't give everybody no beans.
Yeah.
I can't make everybody have a beautiful wife. I can't give everybody a nice family. I love myself, but I'm not sure about this loving my neighbor as myself. Right, I'm not sure if I'm trying to pay their mortgage also.
Yeah.
Pay their light bills too. I'm not sure about that. That's hard. To honor my mother and father, that's hard sometimes. Because they would get me mad when I want to do something and they say I couldn't do it.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
You know, I say, it's not hard. I never killed anybody, but I've been angry enough and probably bitter enough to maybe think about it.
Exactly.
I've been upset with people enough to, if they push me a little further, who knows?
Mm-hmm.
I don't even want to imagine how hard it is to keep some of these commandments the book of law of Moses have given to us. But we thought Jesus had got rid of them, and really Jesus just summed them up for us. He gave a summary of them for us. And the young man went on to say, all these I have kept. What do I still not have? What has I lacked? I've done it all. I've never broken these commandments. I'm on my way to heaven. But for some reason, I feel as though I'm lacking something.
Yeah.
What are you lacking today?
Mm.
You might have kept commandments 1 through 8, but 9 might get you every time.
Mm-hmm.
You might have kept 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, but number 4, you have a problem with. What is it that you lack?
Come on.
Is it hard to believe some of the things that the Bible records? Is it hard to imagine that Jesus could love us in the midst of how we live our daily lives when no one is looking, when no one is around? Is it hard to imagine doing all the things that we are required to do toward our neighbors as ourselves? If you find those 10 easy, even if you find the summary of loving the Lord God with all your heart, mind, and soul, and loving your neighbor as yourself, if you find that something that you're good at also, there's always something else that you could be better at.
Yeah.
And here it is. Jesus knows exactly our soft spot.
That's it.
When he told this young ruler, he said, go and sell what you possess.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, give it to the poor. You will have treasure in heaven and come follow me. And you know, I found that interesting because initially reading this, I misinterpreted it. I thought Jesus was trying to make this young rich ruler become a poor man. But that's not what happened. He just told the young rich ruler, go and sell that which you possess, your possessions, your stuff, your things.
Right.
He didn't tell him to go and liquidate or get rid of his bank account.
Right.
Yeah.
He didn't tell him he had to get rid of his house. He said his possession, the thing. You know, he has a house that he live in. He told him to go and sell his stuff. It's almost like how we see all of these storage spaces popping up around town. Because we got so much stuff that our house is not big enough for our stuff anymore.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I can understand people getting storage houses when you in between homes.
Yeah.
When you're moving and you just staying with somebody and you just got your clothes for the week, but you got all your stuff in storage until you find you another place again. I understand that.
Uh-huh.
I understand that you just moved to another location and you hadn't found a permanent spot yet and you had to put your stuff somewhere until you could find a spot. Find your place of residence. But I'm talking about those who have 3 and 4 bedrooms, 3 and 4 baths, 2-car garage.
Come on.
About $3,000 to $4,000, $3,000 to $4,000 square foot in their house, and still don't have enough room for all their cars. They have to keep their cars outside because not enough room in the garage for them. They have to go and buy a storage space for their other cars and their other possessions and their secret items and stuff because they have so much stuff.
That's possessions.
You know, they look in the closet for a pair of shoes and shoes just fall because so many other pair of shoes in there. They look in their closet for something to wear and they have to almost pry clothes away from each other because so many other clothing items in the closet. That's what we are talking about. Those possessions that can be sold and the proceeds can be given to the poor.
Yeah, yeah.
Notice he didn't say go and give your possessions away to the poor either. He said, sell your possession, get money for them, and then give the people money. People don't need your hand-me-downs. They want money. So they can go and get their own stuff. Then the Bible says that after you sell these and give them to the poor, you will have treasure in heaven. And then he gave them a command to follow me. So not only did this young ruler find this hard, he thought it was impossible because he saw no way how he could do this. There's no way. Do you know how hard I worked for all this stuff?
Yeah, yeah.
Do you know how much overtime I had to put in to get this? Do you know that I had to work 2 jobs to get what I have?
Yeah.
And you expect me to sell it and just give it to some people who just sit on their behinds all day and watch daytime TV and just sit on their behinds all day and talk about what they used to do? You expect me to sell all my stuff and then give the money away to some people who I really don't care about anyway?
Yeah, yeah.
And that's what I got to do in order for me to inherit eternal life.
Mm-hmm.
Not only did the man miss out on heaven, he missed out on following Jesus, which could have made his life so much better.
That's right.
I can imagine as he heard the words of Jesus, his face became shocked because the Bible says this young man heard this and he went away sorrowful because he had great possessions.
Yeah.
You know, don't the man know that if the Lord gave him the possession before, the Lord could give it to him again?
That's right.
He just wanted to know what he sacrificed, what he already had. They probably already gotten tired of anyway. You know, how many times can you go back and look at all your cars? You're going to drive one of them at a time. How many times can you stand outside of your front porch and the world is nine and look across everything as though you own the world? How many times can you look at your possessions and still enjoy them the way you did when you first obtained them? Here we have this young man who came to Jesus thinking he had the right answer already and just wanted Jesus to confirm him.
Yeah.
But what he found out through his radio silence that he didn't have a single reply to Jesus after Jesus told him what he must do. Do you know, because of this young rich ruler, there are so many people who are afraid to ask the Lord, what must I do?
Yeah.
You know why? Because you already know.
That's it.
Leave all that stuff alone.
Uh-huh.
Leave that alone. You don't need that. Quit trying to get stuff that you ain't gonna appreciate no longer than after you had it for about a week or two. Leave all that stuff alone. Do some good with what you have sometime. It's not always about you.
Yeah.
Here it is. Jesus, with this conversation, obviously wasn't telling this man, keep the commandments and have eternal life, because Jesus orchestrated this whole conversation to crush this man's ego and burst his balloon. Do you know what it would be like if more people in the church had their conversations to be crushed by Jesus? Can you imagine what it would be like if Jesus were to burst some of these church people balloons? Some of these big eyes and little us's? Jesus did all that so that he may realize you have never really made it.
That's it. That's it.
As a matter of fact, you never would have made it. In the words of Marvin Sapp. Never could have made it. Because if you think it's about you, you never will make it. If you think that you can qualify for God's favor with your self-righteousness, you are wrong. You have a mission impossible.
That's it. That's it.
You have never obeyed God's commandments perfect enough to get in. And you will never be able to do so no matter. I tell you, some of us are sinning in thoughts right now as we hear this message.
Yeah, yeah.
So what makes you think it's something that we can do?
Do, right.
Now, we think about eternal life, and we ask who can qualify for heaven, who can be a part of, and we try to pick and choose who we think get in heaven based off of our limited knowledge of God's word. Our limited knowledge, for some, not even God's word, just off of what Big Mama and Big Daddy done told them, which was unimpressible at the most. So who can go to heaven? Definitely not the sinners. Definitely not the ones who lie and cheat. Definitely not the ones who steal. So we start determining who we think can go to heaven.
Yeah, yeah.
And we try to imitate them.
That's it, that's it.
Instead of following the Lord.
That's it, that's it.
And some of us, we'll look at some people, and because they can pray real good and long, because they can hoop and holler when they preach, because they can bring tears to our eyes when they sing so melodically, we think, we know they going to heaven. But how many of you know when the music stop, we must live the life that we sing about?
Yes.
When the sermon is over,
right,
we must live the life that we preach about.
All right, all right.
When Sunday school lesson is over, we must live the life that we teach about. We have to live the life of Christ. Because we can't do it by ourselves, so we have to imitate what we see and saw Jesus do. And before I get ready to sit down, you know, let me share that there's no one that is righteous. None. Not one of us is righteous.
Right, right.
All of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. I don't care how much perfume you put on and how much lipstick you put on the pig's snout. We still are some dirty, dirty, dirty people. In the words of my old pastor, we ain't nothing but some dressed up dust.
All right, all right.
We have to realize it's about the Lord.
Yes.
God set the standard, and I don't care how much we realize, though we're in 2023, and we think because times are different. Times may be different, but the Lord isn't.
Amen.
Yeah, yeah.
We might have different interpretations, but the word is still the same yesterday, today, and forevermore.
All right, all right.
So if you think that was because of the old days and that don't apply to us now, we're sadly mistaken. If we want to be right with God through self-righteousness, we are messed up. If we think that by coming to church, if we think that by giving money, if we think about helping old ladies and not sinning as much as we used to, we think that we got it right, and we are wrong. The rich ruler proved to us that he could do all those things and still miss out.
Yeah, yeah.
What we have to understand is It was God's grace. It was God's grace.
Thank you, Lord.
It is God's grace.
Yes.
So why did God give us the Ten Commandments then? Why did we have the summary that Jesus gave then?
Mm-hmm.
Because it's for us.
Mm.
It's a way of keeping us in a place. How many of us, when we look in the mirror, say, oh, you're so ugly? When we look in the mirror, we see a reflection of ourselves. And based off of what we think of ourselves determines what we see when we look in the mirror.
Yeah, yeah.
The mirror will show you a pimple on your face.
All right.
But it won't bust it for you. A mirror will show you a scar on the side of your face.
Mm-hmm.
But it won't put no cream on it for you.
Mm, yeah.
A mirror can show that your hair is thinning, but it won't give you no Rogaine. The mirror can show you that you're getting wrinkles all over your face.
Yeah.
But it won't smooth them out for you.
Yeah.
That's what the word of God is. The word of God will show us how short we have fallen.
Yeah.
But it won't make us get right.
All right.
It will tell us what the Lord has done for us, but it won't make us love him.
Mm.
Yeah.
We have to make the choice that for God we will live and for God we will die.
Yeah.
We have to let the word of God be our mirror to show us our imperfections so we can ask God how to make it right, how to make it better. What more must I do? Stop sleeping. Stop staying up so late. Get some sleep.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Stop going out all times a day. Get some rest.
Right.
Start eating better. Start exercising. The mirror will show us our stuff, but it's up to us once we see it to realize we have something that we can do to make this better.
Yeah.
So here we go, knowing how hard it is. But just like Jesus told us, it may be hard for us. It may be impossible for us, but not for the Lord.
Yeah.
You know, the law is like an x-ray machine. The x-ray can show you that there's cancer, but it can't save us from the cancer.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
And you know, we think about all these different signs and wonders we try to test ourselves with the seat, if we are doing right, if we are living right. And all the things we have to do is just go to the Lord and ask the Lord to show us the way. Show us where we should, because we can see it, but we don't want to acknowledge it.
Uh-huh.
We know it, but we don't want to do anything about it. So, yes, it is hard. Yes, it's problematic. Yes, it is difficult, but it's not impossible when we let the Lord lead us, when we let the Lord direct us, when we let the Lord guide us.
Yeah.
So as I began to tell y'all earlier that there are three ways to live, and when I think about that, we have the no religion, those who don't have any at all.
Right.
We have those who are self-righteous, who think that they can do something to get there. But it's that third way for us, that grace.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, thank
that
you,
that grace, where we are justified, where we are declared righteous, where we are declared right with God, not because of what you and I have done or what we will ever do, but because of his grace.
Thank you, Lord.
His unmerited grace. And it's free. His free favor on us is a gift. And how can he just declare us righteous? Because he's God. We can't declare ourselves righteous. And because we are redeemed by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, God's Son, he came into the world. He lived the perfect life.
Mm-hmm.
He fulfilled every jot and tittle, every letter, every dot of the law of God.
Yep.
How he did it, he's the only one who could have done it because he was God's Son. And then he went to the cross and he gave his life for our substitution. our propitiation. He took our sins, and he's willing to give his righteousness to those of us who believe in him. So the Bible says, for God, it pleased God the Father to make his son to be sin who knew no sin. He was perfect, but he was made sin that we who are sinful might be made righteous. Jesus paid it all, y'all.
Yes.
He paid it all. He paid our debt. He cleared our pathway. He made it right. This is the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's the absolute good news. It's the best news you've ever heard in your life. There's no other way to be right with God. Only when you give that gift through Jesus Christ.
Amen.
That's why we come to realize, yes, it is hard, but it's not impossible. Mm-hmm. I thank God that as we look at Jesus, the Lamb of God that took away the sins of the world, we got to repent and believe in him. Brothers and sisters, today, that's what I want to say to you. We have to repent and believe in Jesus. We have to repent and believe in Jesus. We have to repent and believe in Jesus. This young man, this young ruler, he went away sorrowful because his sin got exposed. What was his sin? His sin was greed. He didn't want to give up something he already had. It wasn't like he had to give up something that he was trying to get. Mm-hmm. He had to give up something that he already had and probably didn't even appreciate anymore. The reason I think that he went away sorrowful is because he loved his possessions more than he loved the Lord.
Mm.
He couldn't let them go. He had this strange thing about he was identified by his wealth. He believed when you are poor, you are not of God. He believed when you don't have, God is not blessing you. He believed lack is synonymous with not being blessed. But when you get rich and richer, it becomes very hard. You buy security for your stuff. You get guns to protect your stuff. You get alarms to protect your stuff. Suppose we were that protective of our relationship with the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Suppose we had a security system around our relationship with the Lord. Suppose we put up burglar bars around our relationship to protect our relationship with the Lord. It's not about our possessions. It's not about our stuff. If you truly want to enter the kingdom of heaven, you have to accept God's gift of grace as that what it is. It's a gift. And it's something about a gift. A gift urges us. A gift almost stirs us to want to do something for the one who gave us the gift. Do you know what it's like to receive a gift that you can't afford to repay? You feel indebted.
Yeah.
You feel like you owe that person something. You know, I see some of the stories, and I remember some of the stories of how sometimes when a fireman comes in to help a couple who get ready to give birth to a child in certain strenuous situations, and all of a sudden, because of the debtness of the couple, they decide to name their kid after that fireman.
Yeah, right.
I've seen situations where people have been so indebted, they just scrounge trying to find something to give that person they're indebted to, something just to show their gratitude. You know, I got to give you something. I just can't let you come to my house and not give you something. You know, there are some people, I remember hearing about how certain grandparents and great-grandparents, when you would go to their house, you had to leave with something, even if it was just an orange, even if it was just a bag of fruit. You know, they don't let you come to their house without leaving with something because they were just so gracious. You thought enough of them to come back and spend a little time with them. You know, when it comes to gratitude, some of us get so filled up, we feel like we have to do something. That's how we are for those of us who have gratitude toward the Lord for the grace he's shown us through the gift he gave us through Jesus Christ. God loved us so much, he gave us the most expensive gift, the very best he had. And what do we do in return?
Yes.
Every now and then, we'll come and say, thank you, Lord.
Mm.
Every now and then, we'll do the Lord a favor by appearing in worship.
Mm.
Every now and then, after begging the Lord for a job, I might go on and give them an offering. I ain't ready to tithe it. You know, 10% a little too much for me. Every now and then, I might give a little something. You know, but when the Lord has been good to you,
yes, he has.
And the Lord is giving you the very best, and you say that you belong to him, mm-hmm. you say that Jesus is your Lord and Savior, and you say you know you're saved because he died for your sin, isn't there something that you should be doing to let people know it?
Thank you. Yeah.
Even if it's just telling people. Mm. Shouldn't it be something? I know it's hard, but it ain't impossible to tell somebody about you being a wretch undone. You were in the HOV lane on the way to hell, speeding, doing 95 miles per hour. Shouldn't it be something that you should be able to let somebody know about your relationship with the Lord and what it's done for you? Don't let this day go by. Don't let this day go by without showing appreciation and letting someone know how much gratitude you have for the Lord and what he's done for you when he gave his son, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Will you realize, will you let it be known? Will you be the spokesperson? Will you be the marketing director for Jesus?
Yes.
And let people know who you are and whose you are.
Come on.
I'm glad today. I'm so glad that, yes, it's hard. I know it's not impossible. I stand before you today telling you I ain't afraid to be rich.
Yeah.
I ain't afraid to be wealthy. Because I believe my relationship with the Lord is so much so, if the Lord asks of me something, I will do it. Uh-huh. Not because I'm afraid. Not because I feel like I'm trying to eat some cheese or suck up. But I do it because I know it's a part of the journey.
Amen.
Yeah.
If he gave it to him before,
surely
he can give it to us again.
Yes, Lord.
If he gave you one house, he can give you another. If he gave you one car, he can give you another. If he gave you one child, he can give you another. If he did it before, he can do it again.
Yes. That's it.
Just because it's hard don't mean it's impossible. Accept this gift of grace and seek the Lord for what he will have you to do in return. Mm-hmm. And I promise you, your life will never be the same.
Amen.
I hope and pray that you receive it. I hope and pray that you receive this in the name of Jesus. Let's pray.
Amen.